I have been doing field works and interviews with the Mexican migrants who go to the US since 1995, first at the border interviewing deportees in the area of Texas and Tamaulipas. And then I went to the communities of origin and worked in Oaxaca, did some interviews in the communities of origin in Oaxaca. I also did ethnographic fieldwork in communities of origin in San Luis Potosí. And more recently, you will see the results of my work in Nuevo León in the north. And I started to think, all these stories that migrants keep telling me, how can I make sense of all these years of listening to these stories? And in the end, I came up with perhaps a little bit simplistic conclusion, but if I have to narrow it down, when I ask people, you know, why do you take these risks? Why do you migrate? Why do you think it's worth it? The answer that I have been hearing through all the years is because I have a commitment to my family, because I want my family to live better. I have a commitment to my children. So I was lucky because I got some funding from the National Council of Science to do a qualitative research on family stories. And basically, what I am doing now is trying to build on the very interesting work of Professor Massey that you've already heard and the work of demographers, and take those profiles from the broader literature and try to find them and find the stories of these profiles in empirical material and try to build narratives from these profiles that could shed light into how migration operates at the microsociological level, but especially because they're concerned with the well-being of their families. Basically, how do people manage to send their children to school and to attend to their ill, and how does migration builds into this? And in doing this, I thought it was very important to understand the context of migration and look at, it was already mentioned, not only migrants, but non-migrant families that are their neighbors in the communities of origin, and sort of try to understand what they share and the challenges they face. So I divided the presentation first one slide in context and then try to explain to you the social policy context of these communities of origin, and then talk about mobile families and transnational families and how their strategies relate to education and health access through social policies in the communities of origin, and then perhaps draw some reflections of this for studies on transnationalism. And hopefully this conference has helped me to realize that there are some interesting comparisons at the level of the family that we can do from Mexican cases to other cases. This is just the context. So I know everyone says, you know, we know this is not the poorest of the poor who migrate, but then migrants come from poor areas in urban areas, in marginalized areas, in urban areas, and also poor areas in the countries of origin. So So in this map, you can see the border. I am working in this northern state of Nuevo León. Now, Nuevo León is a very prosperous state. It's one of the richest cities of the country, is in Nuevo León, Monterrey, where I come from. But yet, if you look at this map, I only put it here because the darker parts are the parts that have a higher percentage of people living in poverty. So basically, the darker it is, indicators show that the conditions are more marginalized and poorer. And if you see Mexico, it has clear dark areas in the south, but then you find patches of poverty everywhere. Mexico has a lot of municipalities of local government, a lot of diverse localities. And in the case of Nuevo León, the south of Nuevo León, where I am doing my research, are communities that are considered to be living in poverty conditions, right? Now, the thing I find interesting with migration, Mexican migration to the United States in general, as we know, is a high percentage is labor population that goes to work in the US. But in a way, as we were commenting before, it's interesting that there is a sort of double exclusion, because people who leave their communities of origin, they come from places that have poor public services, and they are also discriminated because of their conditions of low income and their condition of poverty. So it's interesting because if you look at transnational, you know, and the discussions on migration from the destination point of view, you say they are excluded from policy because they are not citizens. But I think it's interesting that they come from a context that they are also excluded and they also face discrimination in the communities of origin. But in a way, in the communities of origin, policy is always focused towards attracting remittances and hometown associations more than in saying, should these people who are mobile in our country have access to social services, to education and health. So in a way, the discourse on inclusion and inequality is more common in migration studies when we talk about migrants in the destination countries than in the communities of origin. There has been discussion, I acknowledge there has been work, but in my opinion, we still to work a little bit more on those issues. And of course, most policies, especially social policy, assume that populations are static. So basically, if you think about access to the welfare state, of course, citizenship assumes you are in your state, you have access to welfare. And now that there has been a transition from welfare policies into cash transfers and focalized poverties and doing this taxonomy of who is poor and if you are poor, how much help you can have, this taxonomy also assumes that people who live in poverty are people who don't move. So there is this work, for example, by Heinz de Haas that has shown that mobility could be considered as part of the analysis of human development. I thought that was very interesting because that is not how we are understanding the problem and policy is framing the problem today. So just to give you a bit of context, social policy in Mexico, and I am sure in other Latin American countries and perhaps around the world, is more focused on poverty alleviation rather than social rights access and access to social rights. And most of this poverty alleviation is done by conditional cash transfer. So Mexico has this insignia program called Oportunidades, and basically, if you live in poverty and the government considers you a poor family, they will give you cash per month to send your children to school and to do preventive medicine. So you will receive X amount of money per children so they can go to the clinic and they can go to the school. Now, these policies, of course, have been criticized because people say if you use cash transfers, then poor people are going to be dependent on the cash transfers forever, and they are never going to move upwards, so they are going to be dependent on cash transfers. And also, if you focus on cash transfers, you ignore the quality of the services provided, of education and health, and also you ignore the basically the local labor market and the local context of development. So when I was reading this, I say this resonates with debates on remittances, because remittances, you know, the issue some years ago was remittances create the famous migrant syndrome. You know, communities become dependent on remittances and then they are going to keep migrating all the time. And also there's been work on the new economics of labor migration by Taylor that say the analysis of remittances is not considering the local economic conditions of the community. So I say, okay, both people from cash transfers and people from the remittances sector are concerned with similar things. And also, the families I have been studying use cash transfers the same way that migrants use remittances. So in a way, remittances can be considered to be a cash transfer. And this is an idea Jorge Duran also wrote with Douglas Massey some years ago when they talk about migrant dollars and development and how migrant dollars were going to poor populations. So I sort of put the dots together and I said, maybe there is something here for further analysis. And if you think about this, then I think our families are an interesting level to look at, because in a family, of course, you can define that many ways, but if you think that these are reciprocal relationships and that sometimes they have this intimacy that means that people share their daily lives. In the family, you basically can see how all these resources and assets from social policy and from remittances are negotiated and used. So as I mentioned, I've been doing these interviews for some years now, and today I am building stories of 11 transnational families, meaning they have at least one member living in the United States. I've been fortunate because the way I build the network, I know these families. I have a friend who's a friend with these families, and I have been able to talk to them in two different occasions. Last year in 2012 in June, and then I came back to meet them in 2013. So I've been following them up. And I have also been fortunate to speak to people who are recipients of cash transfers. And very interesting, because even though it is true that people who have remittances have better things and sometimes better houses because they have more income, still they are neighbors with people who receive social policy and cash transfers, and their children, should they be in Mexico, go to the same school and they go to the same clinic. So in a way, they share some problematics in the communities of origin. Just to give you a sense, the migrant families I tried to speak to were based on these profiles that demographers have built, extended families, and also nuclear families with the household head living in the US, sometimes circulating, even with the increasing risks. And also families that the father or the mother live in the US and the rest of the family live in Mexico. And more recently, with these new border restrictions, it is my feeling I am finding more people that have been apprehended inside the United States and are being deported. So I found now more families that have been split. When the mother goes to work, they are picked up by a raid in San Diego or by a raid in San Antonio, and then they are returned back. So their children are in the US and the mothers are back, just to give you an example of the heterogeneity. But having said that, and then migrants who are recipients of social policy, we have different kinds of family, but largely we have families that are very young with their children in primary school, and then families that are a little bit older with children in high school, and they, what's interesting is that they have the same goals. Now, I have already mentioned some of the stories. There is a picture of the school here, and basically the some problems are different. Migrants, for example, when they return to their home communities, if their children are in the United States, they have challenges to access school. There has been work done on this by colleagues in Mexico. Basically, they have challenges to integrate with other children. And if their parents are circulating, and if they are circulating with their parents, that also represents access challenges. But also families that are not migrating, that live in poverty conditions, have problem accessing school because they have sometimes no money for transport, right? So sometimes the access problem is different in each case, but there is still an access problem in both cases. And the same thing about the quality. In the case of basic services, there is a lot of lack of provision of health, especially because these families, the part, as I mentioned, is in southern Nuevo León, so it's a highly rural area. And even though people now have what we call a basic services insurance that gives them access, basically if they are sick, the government pays for access to health if it's not something, if it's only the basic things like a diarrhea and those kinds of illnesses. Both migrants and non-migrants have, families have access to this basic insurance, but then again, the quality of the health is also, you know, questionable. And they have family strategies to solve this problem with access, to looking for doctors other places, that are also common. Of course, if you're a migrant family and you have remittances, you can use those remittances to invest in health. But then again, this investment is limited if there is no clinic to where you can go and invest these remittances. So, for example, in the case of migrant families that live in the Valley of Texas, we find, yes, investment of remittances, but also when you need to care for someone who is sick within the family, then what happens is that a person in the United States come back to Mexico to take care of the person who is ill for a while and then go back again to the United States. If you are a non-migrant, someone from the family will come and stay with you in your house and they will care for the ill in your house. So again, differences but similarities between migrant and non-migrant families. And as I mentioned, policy is not prepared to understand these mobile families to basically address, of course, the common problems, but then to address the particularities of these migrant families. And you can end up with cases that seem even surreal if you are not familiar with the context of migration. For example, the Banda family, Banda is a surname, they had 10 children. And five of them were born in the United States, and five were born in Mexico, and one of the girls who was born in Mexico is living undocumented in the United States, and one of the girls that were born in the United States are living in Mexico as a US citizen, and they belong to the same family. And this status gives them access to different education and health services. So basically, you wonder, should we start thinking about labor-associated social policy instead of these policies related more to cash transfers and to static and place-based policies? Should be thinking more about people-based policies. And I know the distinction is questionable, but at least it's a way to start. And I would like to finish by trying to share with you some implications for the understanding of migration. And I believe we have come a long way in accepting that life are transnational and that there is transnational migration and we are away from thinking in bipolar terms. But I still think we need to think a lot about asking transnational questions like inclusion and exclusion. Can we think about them transnationally, both in the countries of origin and in the countries of destination? And can we frame research questions that imply analyzing the social phenomena in a transnational way, also having transnational fieldwork, but maybe having transnational research questions? And also think that transnationalism is a part of a complex set of strategies. If you look at the family level, you will see that it implies mobility and strategies of mobility, mobility to school, mobility to the clinic, mobility to get resources wherever you can. And one of those mobilities will take you to the United States. Maybe another strategy will not take you that far, will take you somewhere else. So it's important to consider this. And also, I think that migrants and non-migrants, yes, are different. I think it's correct, and I agree to say they are different, but they share common problems and they share common context if we look at the communities of origin. And I don't want to stress my argument. I can even go so far and say they face similar contexts because they are marginalized back home and then they live in marginal areas in the destination countries. But suffice to say that in the communities of origin, which is where I have been done my field work, they do share similar problematics. And I think migration studies can tell us a lot about these similar problematics and perhaps building an analysis that is more integral in the sense of the communities of origin and the whole migration journey. Thank you.